Thank you, Mr. Phil, for that wonderful intro. Let's all stand together. We'll get started this morning.
Every time I tried to make it on my own, every time I tried to stand and start to fall, and all those lonely roads that I've traveled on, there was Jesus. When the life I built came crashing to the ground, when the friends I had were nowhere to be found, I couldn't see them, but I can see it now. There was Jesus. In the waiting, in the searching, in the healing, in the hurting, like a blessing buried in the broken pieces. Every minute, every moment, where I've been and where I'm going, even when I didn't know it or couldn't see it, forgiveness at a price I couldn't pay. Well, I'm not perfect, so I thank God every day that there was Jesus.
There was Jesus.
In the waiting, in the searching, in the healing, in the hurting, like a blessing buried in the broken pieces. Every minute, every moment, where I've been and where I'm going, even when I didn't know it or couldn't see it, and there was Jesus on the mountain, in the valleys.
There was Jesus
in the shadows of the alleys.
There was Jesus
in the fire.
Glad to be in the house of the Lord this morning. Say amen with me.
Amen.
Let's give God a hand that there's always Jesus. Amen. All right. Well, welcome to Countryside. I know Mr. Phil beat me to the original welcome with a wonderful song interlude. We appreciate that, Mr. Phil. We're going to do a song of greeting during this time. If you came prepared with tithes or offerings, you can do that. There's a box in the back for that. We're going to sing a song called What a Friend. We are all here, all family, so make each other feel welcome.
Everybody has trials and temptations.
Ooh, ooh, ooh.
Everybody knows heartbreak, isolation.
Ooh, ooh, ooh.
We can lay our burdens down.
Lay our burdens down.
Lay our burdens down.
What a friend we have in Jesus. He's to us, my sins are gone.
has fear. Everybody got worry.
Ooh, ooh, ooh.
Everybody knows sorrow, devastation.
You guys can start wrapping up your conversations. Make your way back to your seats. Don't sit down in them, though. Stay standing. We're going to be singing a song called House of the Lord, but I'm going to need some help. So, countryside kids that know this song and the motions, I want you to come up to the stage. Pearl Prine, I know you do.
Yeah, come on.
I have authority to make orders to you. All right, Katie May, come on. All right, Miss Georgia.
Go, there's three.
Come on,
there
Aubrey.
Comes another one.
Come on, Aubrey. Come on. Come on, Hunter.
We worship the God who was. We worship the God who is. We worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors, he parted the raging sea. My God, he holds the victory. There's joy in the house of the Lord, there's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet, we're gonna shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord, our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet, we shout out your praise. Oh, we shout out your praise. We sing to the God who heals, we sing to the God who saves, we sing to the God who always makes a way.
'Cause he hung up on that cross, then he rose up from that grave. My God, still rolling storms away.
There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet, we shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet, we shout out your praise.
We were the beggars, and now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, and now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise.
Cause we were the beggars, and now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, and now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by His grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We're gonna shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We're gonna shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We're gonna shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place, and we won't be quiet. We're gonna shout out your praise. Oh, we shout out your praise. We shout out your praise. We shout out your praise.
Give these kids a hand. Thank you, guys. So if you came here and Satan had stolen some of your joy, I hope we just stole some of it back. Amen?
It's a really cute sight to see. We had, what, 5 up there? Imagine 100 kids in this room doing that on Wednesday morning for chapel. It's precious. So if you ever want to see a little blessing, come check in the office and visit them on Wednesday morning while they do their chapel. It's so sweet.
Well, good morning and welcome to Countryside. I am Jody.
And I'm Jesse.
And we are glad that you have chosen to worship with us this morning. We're going to go over a few announcements in the bulletin for you, starting with our open house yesterday in Hawthorne.
We had a good turnout. We got some good contacts for the school. So our goal is to open a school. We have a school to the west of us. I'm directionally challenged. Am I right?
You're right?
Yes. To the west of us is Riverside and Trenton. So we have 250 students over there. This is our main campus, and we have 350, so that's 600 total. For some reason, we think we don't have enough to do, so we're going to open one to the east of us in Hawthorne and see how many more students we can add. And our goal is to reach kids with the gospel of Christ and train them to be servants of the Lord and not to have a worldly mindset, but to have a biblical mindset by the time they graduate. That's our goal, right?
That's the principal. That's our goal. That's right. We also have, there's the church over there too. Baptist is over there now too. So they're having their first, second official service at 11 today, right? Yeah.
So we got some good contacts. We had some people kind of walking around from the neighborhood, checking us out. So there's some good energy going over there, had some good food. And Glenn and Cheryl May and the band did a really good job. So send people their way and go visit them whenever you can, but not too much because we want to keep you here too.
That's right. We've got some Bibles up here that need to be taken home and written in. Next week is Bible Drive Sunday. I've got 4 bags of Bibles. They were looking awful lonely out there in the foyer, so I just brought them up here so you can see them. Do we have anybody? 4 people want to take a bag home? I got it. I got you taken care of. 4 people. 4 people? All right, I'll bring it to you.
I've got one. I was told I need to get back on the exercise crew, so I need to get some exercise.
Sweet. I've got one lonely bag. One up back in the back. I got it. It's
a long one. You can get that one. Yep. You didn't go Friday, so. He didn't get to go work out Friday, so he said he's feeling bad, so he needed a few extra steps. All right, so what we want you guys to do is write in the front of those.
What would I do without you as a life's partner helping me, you know?
And there's always bags. So if you see those Publix bags, they're not just random groceries sitting in the foyer. They're full of Bibles waiting for messages to be written in them for Mr. John and Miss Nancy. Yes? And yeah. So flip them open, make sure somebody hadn't already done the job, or you can just add to it. You know, you might need a little extra message.
I didn't check all four of those bags. I did check two. So we want to make you aware of a need that we have. Our youth group is going to Renew, which is a camp that they went to last year. They're going to go again this year. We have some kids in need of sponsorship. If you're willing to sponsor a child, it's $150. You can see any of the frontline youth leaders. That's Zach and Phoebe, AJ and Kaylee, Joel and Bailey, and they can give you the details about that. But we're looking for some kids that want to go but need sponsorship. It's $150. It is Christmas break is when they're going to go, so they're going to be up there over the new year.
Yeah. So it's like after Christmas until like New Year's. So
yep.
We lose our babies for New Year's Eve, but they're having a good time.
Yep. Doing the Lord's work, so we'll give them up for that.
That's it.
You sure?
That's all we got. Okay. Anybody else have anything? Happy birthday to the people in the list. We got a big old birthday list here. Mr. Carl, is he here today? Carl Ropey? No. Nope.
We did forget to talk about the connection cards.
Okay. Georgia Prine. Where's Miss Georgia? Oh, she said here. She's ready for her birthday. Miss Annabelle Allen there. Mr. Allen is preaching at a different church, so they're out there today. And Miss Mindy. Are you turning 30 this year? She is. So happy 30th birthday to Mindy. Do you want to lead a song for us?
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. God bless y'all. Happy birthday to you.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
If you're interested in that, you can see Mr. Steve or Miss Maxine. I mentioned the connection cards. They're out front. If you're a first-time guest with us, please fill one of those out so we can better know how we can serve you and meet your needs. And visit our members, you can use those as well to get messages to Pastor. Those are, again, located in the lobby on either side of the table. And if you are a first-time guest with us today, please make sure you picked up your welcome gift out there. If you didn't get it on the way in, get it on the way out.
Miss Etheline, wave. If you don't know, Miss Etheline is our biscuit lady. What time did you get up to make those this morning? Early. She said early. She's not going to give away her secrets. We're being thrown out here.
Those dove are safe next week.
Did y'all see it shower?
You can't hit me. You're
going to
have a hard time hitting a dove. Pastor's throwing six packs at me. Oh, somebody hit me there. Pick these up and invite people to church. That's what they're for. It's a six pack of invitations. How do people know about our church if you that attend here don't tell them about it? So I'll pick them up, and I'll put these on the back table too. So pick them up and invite six people to church this week if you can. Thank you all for coming and worshiping with us today. Hope you have a great week.
He stole my line. That was a blooper.
Thank you all. Thank you all. Okay, I think I have a team that's coming up to help us sing some hymns together. I'm going to try to get their microphones on so they're ready to go. Amen. All right, let's stand together and sing. Amen. A new name in glory. I was once a sinner, pardon to receive from my Lord. This was freely given, and I found that he always kept his word. There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. And the white-robed angels sing the story. A sinner has come home, for there's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. With my sins forgiven, I am bound for heaven, nevermore to roam. I was humbly kneeling at the cross, fearing not that God's angry frown. When the heavens opened and I saw that my name was written down, there's a new name written down in glory. And it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. And the white-robed angels sing the story. A sinner has come home, for there's a new name written down in glory. And it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. With my my sins forgiven, I am bound for heaven, nevermore to roam. In the book 'tis written, saved by grace, oh, the joy that came to my soul. Now I am forgiven, and I know, by the blood I am made whole. There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. And the white-robed angels sing the story, a sin, clear all. Preacher, do you have the remote presenter with you? Would you make sure it's turned off? Thank you.
No, you should have said, do you now, have it with you? And you should have said, oh, yes, it's mine.
There is no good way to try to go back and finish that song. So we're just going to move on.
Okay?
Thank you. Love is a thief. Of the themes that men have known, one supremely stands alone. Through the ages it has shown, 'tis his wonderful, wonderful love. Love is the theme, love is supreme, sweeter it grows. Since the Lord my soul unbound, I am telling all around. Pardon, peace, and joy are found in his wonderful, wonderful love. Love is the theme. Love is supreme. Trust his wonderful, wonderful love. Love is the theme. Love is supreme. Sweeter it grows. Glory bestows. Bright as the sun. Ever it blows. Love is the theme. Amen. You may be seated. I think it's time for Kids Town. Yeah. They've blown the whistle. I'm telling you. Woo-hoo-hoo. That's the way to go. We're kind of, we'll let them get over there so they can head that way. We've got some video just special for you this morning. Believe it or not, it's been Grandparents' Day Friday and this weekend, I think. So we got a little special on grandparents. Roll that video.
One, two. I need a handheld for just a minute.
Oh, yes, sir.
I'm gonna walk through the audience for a minute. Okay. This is your chance to say something about your grandkids.
Don't tighten this up.
So I need to turn this off when I walk in with that?
No, it's okay.
You got okay.
But don't tighten it.
Don't tighten it. I'm world's worst about tightening stuff up. Mr. Problem Solver, you know, when they come to me, I want to fix it, so. All right, who's a grandparent? On this start, well, we'll go to this side first, okay? How many grandparents you have? I mean, how many grandchildren do you have? Think about it first. Before I'm going to hand you the mic, you think about it.
Two.
I'm gonna let you give their names and their ages. You ready? And their names and ages. Go.
Taylor White and Samantha White. Both of them are engaged to be married. Both of them have heard the gospel and have accepted Christ as their Savior and been baptized by this preacher here.
Amen.
They're not perfect, but they come close.
pass the baton here to the next grandmama.
No, this is not my thing. I have two grandchildren, two great-grandchildren. My grandson is Scotty, granddaughter Madeline, great-granddaughter is Chloe, great-granddaughter is Dixie. I went over last night and helped Dixie organize her room, and that was good.
We have four granddaughters and one grandson, two great-grandsons, and a soon-to-be great-granddaughter.
Do you have their names? Sure, you'll give them their names. This is the only, you get to brag on your grandkids today, you might as well do it, you know.
The five-year-old mom is Haley Rule, and then the two twins are Gracie Rule and Lacey Rule. They're 11. And Alicia, our first grandchild, her name is Alicia Kelly Vasconcellos. She's married to a wonderful young man, Joseph Albert Vasconcellos III. And our great-grandson is Joseph Albert Daniel Vasconcellos, and he's three. And the granddaughter is supposed to be Celeste Aurora Kelly.
All right.
And I would say I am very, very blessed that my granddaughter, my two great-granddaughters are in Christian school. That blesses my heart.
Amen. Amen. Maxine, you have any?
I have Crystal is my first grandchild, and her brother is Christopher, and then Lisa, who went to Christian school here, And where am I at, Steve? I said Lisa. And then my youngest daughter has Michelle is my name. Marissa and
grandchildren.
Mikey. I call him Mikey. Michael. I'm very blessed.
Y'all don't have any yet, right? Go back this way then.
Michelle also graduated from Countryside.
Oh, great grandchildren.
We have 2, 6, and 9 both granddaughters, Layla and Amelia. Right. One on the way.
One on the way, all right.
Well, I got a pile of them. I don't know. I tell you, I got so many of them, I can't remember their names and birthdays. And I'm all the way out to 3 great grandchildren. And we have one due any day, any minute, another grandchild right now. And it's a little girl, and her name will be Everly Danielle.
All right. Named after Danielle. Yeah. All right, any grandparent, granddaddy? You got a granddaddy here? Here we go. It's a good time to brag on your grandkids. You don't get that very often.
I have 3. Cody, he's 23. Granddaughter, Kaylee, she's 18. And another grandson, DJ, he's 13.
All right. You don't have any yet, do you?
I do not.
They're newlyweds. Well, Emma and Justin, hey, from Oklahoma, right? They're newlyweds, too. These are newlyweds, so y'all, you know, y'all are in the same boat. Take y'all a few years to get grandkids, won't it? All right, any more on this row? Okay, I know we got some over here on this end. I know we do.
We have 5 granddaughters. We have 4 biological and 1 adopted. God was good to this family by sending another child to us. We have 4 great-grandchildren. 3 of our great-grandchildren go to school here, so we're here an awful lot. And the best thing that our grandchildren did was sending their kids to this school because they were raised up believing in the Lord. And my little great-grandchildren, Gam Gam, I love chapel, and that just makes my heart laugh.
Amen. All right. Did we get everybody on this side? I think we did. Okay, let's go to the middle. Mr.
You know I got a bunch, don't you?
You have a bunch, I know.
Let me see. I got 3 grandsons that range in age from 20 to 30. I got 2 step-grandsons.
Go ahead.
I have 2 step-grandsons that are in the same age. My son just recently got married for the 3rd time. So I got a whole damn bunch of children in the sense that I don't have any idea what their names are.
Oh, never know what you're going to hear, or do you, Countryside?
I have 1 grandson named after me, Alan Willis III. He's 21. And then I have a 7-year-old granddaughter. Her name is Adley. And she recently accepted Jesus into her heart, and she's on the schedule to be baptized. They live in Tallahassee, so that's where they go to church.
Pass right down to you right there.
I have a grandbaby named Elsie Wells, who we acquired through marriage. Taylor married Brandon, and he had her, so she's the love of all of our lives. We fight over her.
I have 4 granddaughters. Malia and Jada go to school here, and Aubrey and Lily live in Tampa.
That's just a giggy.
We have 6 granddaughters. I'm including my acquired granddaughters through marriage, and 4 grandsons, and that includes Joel.
I think most of them are here with you today.
And they're perfect. They're all perfect.
Nope. 10. 5 boys, 5 girls.
10? You got 10? Wow, that's wonderful. Y'all have any right over there? You don't have any yet, right? You have any? Not yet. You got any?
I do.
We have 4 granddaughters. Gracie is 16, Emma is 15, Hannah is 13, and Becca is 12. And then we have Joseph Tong, who was adopted from China.
Awesome. Yeah. Miss Yvonne?
I have 1 grandson. He's 7 years old.
and King Joshua.
I have 5 grandsons and 2 step-granddaughters. The oldest one is William Moore Gracie, the 5th. He's just turned 16. TJ is 13. Coben is 13. And Caleb is 10. And Tobias is 10. And Nija is the oldest. And she's, I guess she's 19, and she's serving in the Navy. And she's out in California. And then I have Olivia, and she's 10 also.
I'll start by saying, when our first one was born, I told Jerry I don't remember loving our kids like I do these grandkids. And Kelsey's 25, and Jerry announced to the church she was a keeper that next Sunday morning. And Camden and Sydney are 23. And Layton is 21. Anna's 19. Daniel's 18. And Emma Kate is 11, and she's in a Christian school in Williston.
All right.
And they've all been saved and baptized. When I married my husband, he had 8 kids. So as you know, there's a bunch of grandkids, and I cannot tell their names or their ages.
I have a son named Gene Offler, and he and his wife Sheila have 4 children, and the 2 oldest sons are married, and between them they have 5 little children. So I've got 4 grandchildren and 5 great-grandchildren. I'm very lucky.
I have 11 grandchildren and 3 great-grandchildren. One, the little boy's name is Stetson, and the little boy, his little brother's name is Bo, and the little girl's name I can't remember because she's new to the family.
Thank you much. I don't have grandkids yet, right? Morgan, don't get started yet. I'm sorry. I keep getting out of your way. See, I know she's got a bunch.
Robbie and I have 14 grandchildren, and I'm going to ask for their help today. If you're my grandchild, please stand up. And y'all can tell your name and your birthday. Joel, everybody. Okay, there they are. I can't remember all their names and birthdays.
Huh? What?
And then the other ones are in. Robbie can straighten us out. I don't know. There they are, all on my arm, right here.
Ella and I have 2 grandsons. The oldest one, Cody, he's a captain in the Air Force Station in South Carolina. And the youngest one, Jacob, is with my daughter in Ocala. He's a engineering CAD technician designer with an engineering firm in Ocala.
We have 8 grandchildren, 6 boys, 2 girls. We have Grayson, he's 22. Emma Grace, she's 22. Gibbs, he's 20. Lawson is 17. Everett is 15. Serenity is 14. Wiley is, I'm not sure, either 13 or 12. I'm not sure. 13, I think. And Will is 8. And they all have accepted Christ as their personal savior.
Greg and I are the proud grandparents of little 3-year-old Riley, and she's a handful. She's enough right now.
Betty has 7 grandchildren, and she's lost count of all the great-grandchildren. But I have 3, Easton, which is 8, and he goes here to Countryside, and Oakland is 3, and Adlin is 7.
Back down this way. There you go.
We have 2 grandkids. Tim is 8 and Abigail is 7.
grandchildren, three step-grandchildren, and one great-grandchild, and one that's going to be born in November.
Pass it back.
I have three grandsons. They all go here. Hunter is 8. Chase here is 1 year old today.
And hey!
Tucker is 4 and a half months. And he's so, oh, there he is.
Robbie, do you want to straighten your wife out up there?
I think there's 15, counting Joel and Kayla. I'm too old and tired to name them all.
Who are we missing? Anybody didn't get to talk about your grandkids? Where are you at if you didn't? All right. I don't want to short circuit you. Miss Bonnie? Preacher's wife has to tell you something. Wait a minute.
No. You forgot your mom and dad.
Yeah, well, they're, mom and dad, Sandy, how many does mom and dad have? They have 35 grands and 40 greats, I think. And that's our founding pastor here. You remember, you heard about the population explosion, right? Well, they caused it. So today is Grandparents' Day, and I want to speak for the next few minutes on God's secret weapon, the super grandparents of our world. And I thank God. We'll just think about, try to add all those numbers up. I started to do it as we went, but there are a lot of children represented right here that you've produced. Amen?
Amen.
And hopefully we can continue to produce children that will be godly children, go out and change this world in the right way. A lot of people are having children and they're not raising them in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. So we endeavor and encourage you to do that you raise your children to honor and respect our Lord Jesus Christ and build their life upon the book, God's book. So let's begin with prayer, and we'll start. You ready? Lord Jesus, I thank you so much for the grandparents represented here today, Lord. I pray a special blessing upon them, Lord, because in today's world, we certainly need some godly grandparents to influence the children out there today. So give them strength, courage, and the anointing of your Holy Spirit, Lord, and help them leave here today refreshed and anointed from you for this great task. In the name of Jesus, I pray. And all God's children said, what?
Amen.
Amen. Well, you think about grandparents today, and Mark, we got an A, and we should have had an A there. I don't know where the A went. There's B. I think that's going to be down later on. There has been a grandparent boom in recent years. In the 80s, there were 40 million grandparents in America. That's a lot of grandparents. In 2011, there were 65 million. In 2020, there were 80 million. And now we're, you know, two years, almost 3 years past that. So you can see the explosion of grandparents in the world, and particularly in our nation. And really, you start thinking about, of you grandparents, how many of you are actually helping raise your grandchildren? Raise your hand for a minute. Let me see. Anybody out there? Okay, she's helping. Got 1, 2, 3, 4. Four of them, five of them right here in our crowd. That's normal these days. We have a lot of grandparents bringing their children they're raising to our Christian schools these days, and it's quite normal. 1 in 6 Americans live in a multi-generational household. You remember on the Waltons how Grandpa and Grandma Walton lived in the house, and you had, you know, Mr. and Miss Walton and the kids. Well, that's more common today than it has been in recent years. 7.8 million children live in grand families where grandparents or other relatives are the householders. 7.8 million. 2.7 million grandparents are responsible for most of the basic needs of the children that they live with them. That's a very strange statistic, isn't it, to think about? And I think I haven't really thought about other countries, but that's here in America pretty much. But see, I really believe that God's special weapon today are the super grandparents that we have. Godly grandparents have a powerful influence on children and on your children. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 or 3 and following says, Timothy, I thank God for you, the God I serve with a clear conscience, just as my ancestors did, night and day, constantly remembering you in my prayers. I long to see you again, for I remember the tears as we parted, and I will be filled with joy when we're together again. I remember your genuine faith. Now listen to this. For you share the faith that first filled your, who? Grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and I know that same faith continues strong in you. Think about that. The influence of grandparents on children, and especially if they're actually living under your roof. Ours don't live under our roof, but there have been times in our lives where we either lived with them and spent time in their homes. When we came back from college, we spent a time in her parents' home and my parents' home after a serious illness that I had. We had to spend about a year there, but it was a wonderful time to be able to spend time with our children right there in the same roof with their grandparents. See, godly grandparents affect generations to come. I remember my daddy's mother. We called her, my grandma was Mama Lou on that side of the family. And then her mama was Grandma Campbell. And Grandma Campbell and Mama Lou were godly, godly women. They were church organists and Sunday school teachers. And they really were the, although my granddaddy was a godly man, they were the spiritual backbones of that family. And they had an influence even to this day. I've got their Bibles in my office in there, and they're very old and deteriorating. I have to keep them in a Ziploc to keep them from falling apart. But I think about how much time they must have spent, and I can see the notes in their Bibles, and I can think about when I was a young little boy and hearing them talk about serving God and praying for us, and I can imagine that those grandparents prayed for me before I was ever even old enough to hardly breathe, and I was a newborn. I can just imagine in my mind them praying for me like they did their own children that I would become a godly man. And their prayers are coming true. You see, godly grandparents affect generations to come. Deuteronomy 7 verse 9 says, "Know therefore that the Lord thy God, he is God, the faithful God, which keepeth covenant and mercy with them that love him and keep his commands to 1,000 generations." Think about that. Keeps his commandments for 1,000 generations. One place it says he blesses those for 1,000 generations, you know. But also the other side of that is the curses are on those that don't love God, and the curses go for that other way of 1,000 generations, but the blessings go for 1,000 generations forward for us that are trying to do right, and we raise our children right, and we become grandparents. And you saw all the grandparents that are here today, and you have a desire like I do to affect our grandsons and granddaughters. Most of you said something about what? My children have accepted. You heard that, didn't you? Time and again, my children have accepted Jesus. That's what it's all about. Knowing Christ is our Lord and Savior and passing that on to the next generation. See, God expects grandparents to be respected. We live in a world today that doesn't respect adults and doesn't respect older people. If you watch how children are acting these days, unless they've been raised in a home like yours in which you've taught them to respect the older people, the world out there at large does not respect the aged. And many times they're mocked and ridiculed by the media and other peoples. But Leviticus teaches us this. Stand up in the presence of the elderly and show respect for the aged. Fear your God, for I am the Lord. See, the direct words from God himself that says to respect the aged. Give honor to them. And Romans talks about give honor to whom honor and respect to whom respect. We're supposed to do that. And so you need to teach your children, if you have young children, be teaching them to respect the aged and the older people. It's a good idea when they walk into the room to teach your children to stand up until everybody is seated again. Have them stand and say, "How are you doing, sir?" Respect. Look them in the eye. Talk to them. I know some children that just kind of like walk out of the room when the adults come in, and old people especially, they don't show any respect for them, and we need to teach that because God is very, very clear on that. See, his clear instruction is that we do that. Teach your children and grandchildren about God, okay? Teach your children and grandchildren about God. We're supposed to do that. Deuteronomy 6, our teachers all have to memorize this, and every time they have a teacher convention, they're required to say these verses and memorize these verses. In Deuteronomy chapter 6, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy might. And these words which I command thee this day shall be in thine heart. Thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children. Thou shalt talk of them when thou sittest in thine house, when thou walkest by the way, when thou liest down, when thou risest up. And thou shalt bind them for a sign upon thine hand, and they shall be as frontlets between thine eyes. And thou shalt write them upon the posts of thy house and on thy gates. Do you know what the Jewish word, what they call this, the Jewish people? They have learned this their whole life. Anybody know? I know you know it. So say it. The Shema, remember? Listen. Listen. The Lord thy God is one Lord. See, God says, listen. This is the way it is. This is the way I want it to be. And this is what you're to pass on to the next generation. You're to love the Lord thy God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and to teach it continually to your children. That's why Christian education is so important, because what we do is we reinforce what you should be doing in your home. If a person comes to us and all they want to do is keep their girls from having babies when they're young and keep their kids off drugs and try to separate them from evil stuff, and that's all the reason they bring them to a Christian school, it's not a good reason. We have a lot of parents, that's what they want. They just want us to protect their kids till they get old enough to leave here. That's not the purpose of our Christian school. The purpose of our Christian school is to reinforce these verses that should be have been taught in the home. So parents should be teaching it, grandparents should be teaching it, and we reinforce, we become, in fact, the Latin term for us is we're parents in place of. When you put your children under the tutelage of a Christian school, we become the parent in your place. And what we want to do is reinforce what you've already been doing. We can't undo what you did. See, a lot of parents bring their kids to us when they're all messed up. They're about 12 or 13, and they're starting to get rebellious. And here, let's put them in a Christian school. Y'all straighten them up. Listen, not our purpose. That's not why we're here. We're not a reform school. We're a preparatory academy for Christian leaders and Christian workers. And we want to build Christian leaders just like you are, grandparents and parents that are loving the Lord and trying to do right. We want to produce those kind of people in the world today. So grandparents, live a consistent Christian life. It's important that you live what you say that you do. If you claim to be a Christian, live like a Christian. And that doesn't just mean Sunday morning. That means Monday through Saturday, that you demonstrate that before your children. Deuteronomy chapter 4, watch out, be careful, never to forget that what you yourself have seen. Do not let these memories escape from your mind as long as you live. Now listen to this part. Read it with me. And be sure to pass them to your children and your grandchildren. Let's do it again. I got about four of you. And be sure to pass them on to your children and your grandchildren. What's it talking about? Talking about what you've learned about God and what you've learned from the Bible. Listen, we want to pass it on to your children and your grandchildren, and we want you to be that kind of a grandparent. Leave important markers for your family as you go. My mama and daddy had mamas and daddies that left important markers, and their parents and grandparents left important markers. Our first fourth great granddaddy back, came to Florida by way of horseback in the 1890s from Texas. He was called to preach. The Texas Baptist sent him to Florida to plant churches. That's how we ended up in Florida, as our great-great-granddaddy came with his family by wagon. I've been trying to figure the whole trip out because we don't have a written record. But I assume and think that they may have gotten on a boat at maybe Galveston and then come to Pensacola, bought wagons, and then came from there all the way down around Lakeland area where they started. I'm trying to figure that out. I'm going to write a novel one day about how great-great-granddaddy got to Florida. But anyway, we have the actual printed records of when they paid them $65 a year back then to come to Florida to plant a church. That was their wages. That's a lot of money, wasn't it? $65 a year was the support that the Southern Baptists paid them. And see, they had a track record. They left markers for us. And their names are in a lot of the Southern Baptist records. Southern Baptist wrote some stuff recently about 4 or 5 years ago in the Baptist Witness about our family. And we learned stuff we didn't even know. How do we learn those things? Well, markers were left. records were left of what they had done, what they had been trying to do for God. And they never dreamed that we'd be doing it today, but they prayed for it. They prayed for their children and their great-grandchildren. Lord, bless us and help our children to be a blessing to Florida and a blessing to the kingdom of God, and help them to be Christians and plant church. And here we are. Why are we here? We're here because grandparents at some point left some markers for us to follow, and I thank God they did. Now, I want to give you six tips to be a super grandparent. How many of you want to be super grandparents? Well, you grandparents, raise your hand. I know. Go like this. Yeah, I want to be super. Okay. I already think you're super, but I want you to be better, and God wants you to be better. Here's the first thing. Always pray for them every day. My wife is a very great, I'm a prayer warrior, but not like her. She's a prayer warrior. She's always praying. And she prays for our grandchildren. I do too, but she's more consistent because she's there more. And close. We live about 43 miles that way, and they all live within 5 miles of it. So she's closer. I'm over here working and around the schools and traveling between three schools, and she's home more. She's able to think more about them, and she's constantly holding them up in prayer. I'm thankful for that, and we as grandparents need to pray for them like that every day. Schedule availability, Skype, Facebook, Twitter, whatever you're using. I don't know what we're using right now. I know Facebook has thrown me off so many times, I'm having trouble getting on there. So I don't even know if any of you are getting my blogs, because they've kicked me off too many times. I'm too opinionated and away from what their direction is, I guess. But schedule availability with your children. I have on my phone, I left it over there, but I have that, what's the name of that one we track them on? Find Friends. Anyway, Find My Friends. I know where they're at. And I say, well, Grayson's in Ocala and Gibbs is over here. And so when I see them, when I see their little signal with their initials on it, I start thinking about them and praying for them. And I try to call them, say, hey, you okay? What are you doing way over there? I'm worried about you. Why, you know, no, we're fine, Granddaddy. You're worried too much. Don't worry about us. We're good. But it makes me think about them. I see it on the screen. I know where they're at. And it reminds me to think about them and pray about them. And I try to call them and text them, that sort of thing. Mimi, they call her Mimi. Mimi, she texts them and talks to them more than I do. But it's good to do that as grandparents. Try to stay in touch with them. They need to hear your voice. You need to talk to them. Let them know you love them and pray for them. Ask caring questions about them, and then listen. So many times we talk more than we listen, and we should listen to them and find out what's going on in their life, and listen to them. Tell them life experience stories, what God has done for you and how He's brought you through. They're going to face some stuff they haven't faced yet, and you've already been there. You've done that. You got the T-shirts. You got the scars a lot of times, and you can tell them life stories that and how God helped you through. Get information out from mom and dad. I should have put information there, but get information from mom and dad. Tell them, you know, what's going on with Grayson? What's going on with Gibbs? You know, and try to get the parents to talk a little bit and tell you what's going on. Keep you posted, because sometimes you can't get full information from them. Tell them often that you love them and you're proud of them. I don't know if you've ever read the book, The Blessing, but I would really strongly encourage you, especially if you have children and grandchildren, to get the book, The Blessing, by Dr. Gary Smalley. I promise you, that one book, besides the Bible, that would be my second book that I would make a part of my life if I were you. The Blessing, the gift of the blessing. And in that book, Dr. Smalley and others that he cites, excuse me, He illustrates and shows you from the scripture how that all the way back to Abraham, when God said, in you all the nations of the earth shall be blessed. Remember that? The Abrahamic blessing. And ultimately, how are we blessed through Abraham? What's the ultimate blessing? Jesus, right? Jesus came through the seed of Abraham. But more than that, there's the blessing that every father should be conveying to his family. We should be conveying the blessing to our family. And there are five or six things. I'll preach that series again for you one day, but I've got a whole series on the blessing. But I would just encourage you to get the book and start practicing those principles. My wife bought that book at a conference we went to. We went to a teacher's conference, and she bought, oh, honey, you got to read this book. Yeah, I know, I do. I'll read it. So she put it on my nightstand. Yeah, honey, you need to read the book. I said, I will, honey, I will. And I've never really got time to get around to it. And one day I finally said, you know, I've been telling her I'd read it. I better read it. I couldn't put the book down. And I promise you this, that one book probably revolutionized the way I dealt with my children and grandchildren more than any other book besides the Bible. And I learned things that I wish I had done when I was younger and things I wish I had said when I was younger. But we need to be conveying our love and our acceptance of them, you know, every single day as much as we can. The world is not giving them that, okay? And their peers are not giving them that. They're hearing a lot of, you know, you don't measure up and you're not as good as your sister and I wish you were like so. And they hear a lot of that kind of stuff, but they never hear, I love you. God gave you to me, and I'm so thankful that you're in my life, and you, God gave you to us when you were born, and ever since that time, we have prayed for you and loved you, and we know your life is going to turn out, and you're going to be something for God one day when you grow up. You see, they need to hear those kind of things rather than, you just don't measure up. You're not as good as your brother. I wish you were like so-and-so, or you're no good. You're just like that person. No, they don't need to hear that kind of nonsense. They need to hear words of love and affirmation from us. And you need to tell them that you love them and are proud of them very often. Now, this hadn't been a long sermon, but I want you to know that God wants you to be a super grandparent. I pull this off of Focus on the Family because it really touched my heart. And here's a 7 essentials for grandparenting your grandkids. And here's what Focus on the Family wrote. And number one, understand your impact potential. And kind of like the fact we do have a big effect, like I said before. Number two, clarify your role. You're not the mommy and daddy, okay? But you are to be the respected elders in the family. And you clarify that you, hey, I'm not your mom and dad. I can't take their place, but I would like to love you and let you know grandma and granddaddy are praying for you, you know. We think you're great. Sometimes we think you're too great. We overlook your failures a lot of times, don't we, grandparent? And then number three, model a life of goodness, as I said in our outline, that, you know, to make sure you live a consistent life. Number four was create great relationships with the parents. Don't become an adversary between the child and the parents, because children like to divide and conquer, okay? So make sure you're an advocate with the parent, have a good relationship with them. When you can't talk about Jesus, sometimes you can't. And I like to talk about Jesus, you know me, and I'm going to try to talk to anybody I can. But sometimes you can't, and sometimes the parents will resist you in there. But look for opportunities in a good way to tell them about Jesus and look for open doors in their lives. Balance grace and truth is another point, number five, that they list, you know. Because it's true does not necessarily mean you have to hammer them with it like an axe, okay? Learn how to balance grace and truth with your grandchildren. And I would say this to you, always err on the side of mercy, okay, rather than judgment. Err on the side of mercy. Jesus, the one I serve, erred on the side of mercy every single time, okay? A woman caught in the act of adultery, thrown before in public, they caught her in the act, and how did Jesus treat her? Was he judgmental or was he merciful? He's merciful, wasn't he? So we need to model that as grandparents. And adapt to their world if you can. It's hard to keep up with the media these days. The media is changing so much. But adapt as best you can so you can communicate with them. Some of you grandparents try to dress. You can't dress like them, okay? You try to sometimes, I know. You try to dress like them and, you know, you can't quite do that, but do the best you can to adapt to their world. They live in a different world than we do, okay? And you need to learn how to communicate in this world. Some people say, why do you go to Facebook and all that stuff? I said, it's how people communicate. You can't even communicate with people today unless you know how to get on the media that is being used today. Learn how to use it and learn how to communicate that way. And then find your greatest life purpose. Your greatest life purpose is to see your descendants in heaven. Amen? You want your grandchildren saved. You want them to go to heaven one day when the time comes for them to leave this earth. And you play a vital part in God's plan. Super grandparents. Listen, you are super. Grandparents are super. God made them. This is what Chuck Swindoll wrote. I love this. I'm going to read this little paragraph or two to you from what he wrote about grandparents. And he said, "Isn't God good? Generation after generation, he provides fresh sets of grandparents, an ever-present counterculture in our busy world. Lest everyone else get so involved that they no longer stop to smell the flowers or watch the tiny ants hard at work, these special adults are deposited into our lifestyle account. They made enough errors to understand that perfectionism is a harsh taskmaster and self-imposed guilt is a hardened killer. They could be superb instructors, but their best lessons are caught, not taught. Their Christianity is seasoned, filtered through the right weave of realism, heartache, loss, and compromise. Jesus is not only their Lord, he's their friend and longtime counselor. Like a massive tree, they provide needed shade, they add beauty to the landscape, and they don't mind being used. They're there, even if not much is happening, they're there. While this surge of what some would call sentimentality, well, my life took a new dimension not long ago. Another hat was added to those already wearing. It's one that will become increasingly more significant as time passed. I realized Ryan Thomas was born to our older son and daughter-in-law, 6-pound, 8-ounce grandson, who will provide my wife and me with a chance to try again." That's good, isn't it? We get a chance to try again. And I thought those words of how grandparenting is important. And every generation, God provides new ones. And you just happen to be the ones he provided right now. You super grandparents, we love you so much. And I'm thankful that you're alive right now. And I'm thankful that you have the grandparents that you told us about. And I pray for you. And I pray that God will use you and use us as we minister to our 8 and your 5 and your 4, however many you have, that God will help you to be a super grandparent and that he will honor his word by you following and doing what he told us to do. And with that, we're going to close and just say, God bless you. Happy Grandparents Day. If you get a chance, call your grandchildren today, this afternoon. Talk to them. Tell them you love them. Amen? Amen. Now, if you're here today and you don't know Christ is your Lord and Savior, and you'd like to, Maxine and Steve will be in the library, which is that room right there under the speaker in the back. And if you'd like to know Christ as your Lord and Savior, if you've never met him yet and you want to seek salvation and then be baptized into the family of God, please go back and see them. If you're here and you'd like to be a part of this church, we're looking for church members all the time. We want everybody to join if they will. And all we ask from you, the way we receive members is, number one, that you have accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior. If you hadn't, we'll help you. Second thing is, if you already know Christ and you're coming from another church, we accept members by letter. Hey, we ask for your letter from the other church, and they send us a letter saying, "Oh yeah, they were great members at our church, and we're glad to send you a letter recommending them for your church." We receive letters by that. Or members like that. We also receive them by statement of faith. You come and say, "Hey, I'm a Christian. I don't have a church letter anywhere, but I want to be a part of your church." And we receive you like that. But we do ask that you submit to our baptism. If you haven't been baptized by immersion, we ask that you submit to a biblical baptism. We believe that biblical baptism is baptism by immersion. And when the word baptize, if you study it, is an untranslated word. And it means to dunk under, to submerge. That's what that word means. And so the two distinctives that set us apart as a Baptist church, we believe in the two ordinances that Christ left the church. One of them is believer's baptism. We wait until a person has old enough to understand and has accepted Christ as their Lord and Savior. And then they submit to immersion, baptism by immersion. And then the other ordinance is what we call the Lord's Supper. Some people call it communion, but we have a monthly time where we set aside on a Sunday to do the Lord's Supper. So Jesus said, "Baptize those that believe and teach them to observe all the things I've told you and practice the Lord's Supper till I come." And so those are the two orders from Christ to our church. Carry out the Great Commission, win people to Jesus, then baptize them, and then take the Lord's Supper, you know, in your church occasionally. Some people do it every week. Some people do it once a month. Some churches do it once a year. We do it once a month. So I just want to let you know we want you to be a part of this church. If God is drawing you here, we're thankful that you're coming. And those invite cards, the reason I threw them at Jody, that was an attention getter. People only come when you say that word. The most important word for you this whole week is invite. One more time, we need to invite. We invite people to our church. Now, we probably have 15, 20, maybe 30 at Hawthorne today. For those of you that are new, we have a brand new East Campus, 20 miles that direction, called Lakeside Baptist of Hawthorne. And we have numerous members of ours are over there helping them today. So you see the holes that are here. Let's see if we can fill them with new people next week. Amen? Will you try? Would you say, I'll try? Come on, raise your hand. Don't look. I got two people raising their hand. Need about 3/4 of you. Invite. Amen? All right, Brother Mark, let's have one song, and then we're going to have a closing prayer and go. During this song, if God is speaking to you about salvation or about church membership, quietly leave and go back, turn right, and go into that room under the screen right there, and Steve and Maxine will receive you back there. Special need and need special prayer, go back to the prayer room.
Cast all my cares upon you. I lay all of my burdens down at your feet, and any time I don't know what.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we ordain and dedicate each grandparent, Lord, that is here today. Lord, they are ministers for you from this church to their family, Lord. So today, with all my brothers and sisters doing and thinking the same thing, we dedicate them and ordain them as your ministers in their family. Use them in a powerful way to affect the next generation and bring many, many of their children and grandchildren to saving knowledge of Christ and those around them. Help us to do that. In the name of Jesus, I pray. And all God's children said, amen. Amen. Don't forget your green 6-pack of invite cards in the back.